Good morning. We're glad you could join us this morning for prayer and worship service as we come to worship the Lord today. As you can see, we are still an empty house of the Lord, but we look so forward to when we can all get back together and fill this sanctuary up.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of hope. His voice to me is calling, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
We're just so glad you could join us today, and we've got a few announcements this week that we just want to go ahead and share with you. We've got some praises. One of our members who we had been praying for, her daughter-in-law who had had cancer, has now been told that she is in remission. And so we have answered prayers there. Also, we want to go and make sure we tell everybody Donna Bo happy birthday this week. She had a birthday, and so Donna, happy birthday, and we wish you many, many more. And then also, next week at 4:00, we need to have a church council meeting in the fellowship hall at 4:00. So I need all the church council members to be there. We will have social distancing, but bring a mask also, so that we can take care of some church business, which we need to get done. Also this week, I want to, if you haven't rode by the church, I invite you to come ride by and look at the grounds. I'm gonna tell you, the Building and Grounds Committee have done a wonderful job of keeping things up out here, and some of the work that's been done. I really want to appreciate them. They had the steeple pressure washed and repainted. We had some siding that had been damaged from some wind storms that had come through earlier in the year. They've fixed that. They've been cutting the grass, even in all this hot weather, getting this done. And I certainly appreciate the Building and Grounds Committee doing that, as well as the Cemetery Committee taking care of the cemetery. And also, I mentioned Donna Bow a minute ago. I want you to come by and just see the sign out front and the flower bed that she has been keeping up. I'm gonna tell you, it's as pretty as I've ever seen it, and the flowers are beautiful out front. And so, Donna, we thank you for the work that you do with the flower bed. So, you know, we know that it takes effort and it takes work for these people to do that. And we want more of you to get involved with us in some of that, more than just coming to church on Sunday and listening to a sermon, but be involved in the work of the Lord. So with that in mind, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God and Father, we do thank you that you allow us to be a part of your ministry, that we all have different talents and we all have different tools and we all have different abilities that we can use in a ministry for you. Though some of us can preach and some of us can teach, but some of us have the art of craftsmanship and some of us have the art of gardening. Some of us have other skills that can be used by you. And Lord, we thank you for those that use their skills for your purpose. And we pray and thank you for each and every one of them. And Lord, we pray that as we go through this service today, that you will be with the service, that you will lead it and you will guide it. It will be your Holy Spirit. And for those watching at home, that they will feel your Holy Spirit. They will feel your presence because you are God, the one and only God. God, Father, Son, and a God, the Holy Spirit. And we thank you. And we give you the honor and the glory for us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Just the time I need him, he's all.
Series that we've been doing this month, and Fear Not. And I hope that you have been studying and practicing what we've talked about the last 3 weeks, and today we're going to keep on talking about Fear Not. You see, what I want you to understand is that we get fear, and a lot of times it's Satan throwing that fear at us. He's trying to make us scared of every situation and circumstance that's going around, and he's going to be doing it until the very end. So I want you to understand that fear is a natural part of life, and we need to be able to deal with it. We need to embrace the reality of it ever being present, but we also have an ever-present Savior, Jesus Christ, and know that he is always going to be there with us. No matter what the situation is, he's there. There's nothing that surprises him. Though we might be surprised, he's not surprised. So we should feel a sense of peace about the future. I mean, right now, with all, you know, was having a conversation with some of my family last night, and they were, you know, talking about concerns about the way the country's been going, and worried about the elections coming up. And I said, well, it doesn't matter. I said, God's in control. And I said, so I feel a sense of peace about the future because I know that God's in control. He's carried me through everything I've been through so far. It wasn't always easy. Many times there were some mountains, tops that I got to go to, and it had been some very deep valleys that I've been through. There have been some very bright places I've been to, but there's been some very, very dark places that I have been to. But he's been with me each and every step of the way. And sometimes I might not have felt like he was there, but he was. And so we can feel confident that no one has to do it alone. You see, we can go confidently, as we've been talking about in this series, and we apply the tools for greater understanding and dealing with fear and its effects that it has on us. So with that in mind, I want to go to the Lord in prayer before we begin our sermon.
Jesus, we thank you for your constant presence and help in our lives. We help and trust the realities of your commitment to your people, the commitment to your church, and that you give us the courage to walk boldly through life, knowing that you walk with us, and that most of the time that you are the one carrying us through, though we might not realize it. And Lord, I pray that those that are listening today will learn that when fear comes upon them, to put it into your hands. Lord, we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, the scripture is going to be from the book of John, chapter 16, verse 33, and Joshua, chapter 1, verses 4 through 9. And we're still talking about fear not. And today, we're particularly talking about you're not alone. Because we've covered a lot of ground in the last month, and in the short time that we've been talking through some challenging ideas and practices that you need to put into practice in your life. Not the least of which, the idea that you can be victorious in the battle against fear. I know so many people that have just been so frozen in fear and they were scared to do anything. You know, we have so many times that we have breakthroughs for church members, and sometimes we don't hear about it. And that's why during the announcements, we've gotten a call earlier this week of a family that's been worshiping with us, and the daughter-in-law had been diagnosed with cancer, and we got the call this week that she is in remission and doing very well. You know, that's a victory. You know, anytime you hear that C word, cancer, that immediately throws fear into your life. And so we've got to remember that no matter how big or how small the victory may be, that it's an encouragement for others to hear the testimonies. The flip side of victory is one that many of us have also experienced, and at times it's what we call defeat. Other times it's been labeled discouragement. Either way, there are realities that we will experience in the long journey as we go through life. The journey for sanctification as we grow in faith. Does it mean that we failed and that we were beyond redemption? Certainly not. I mean, after all, the apostles, almost all of them, well, all of them did fail Jesus at one time or another. You see, it was because of this that God sent his Son, his one and only Son, to redeem the world, because he knew that we needed, that we need the eternal life. He knew that we couldn't get there on our own, because too many times through history, as you went through, you see that the people fail. And so there are times that we'll experience defeat and discouragement. There are other times and seasons where we will have a great growth in the depth in our faith. And most of the time, when we really have the growth in our faith, is in that valley and in that period that we feel that we've been defeated. You see, the journey of sanctification, growing closer to Christ, ebbs and flows. It's up and down. You know, it's been so many times that you will have those mountaintop experiences, and man, you just think everything's great. I remember when we would go to Promise Keeper events, and you're there, and man, you're on that mountaintop, But then you come back home and it doesn't take long and you're back at the reality of work and family and things going on around you. And it's kind of, would be kind of discouraging sometimes. But we know that no matter how discouraged we may become, we know that Jesus stays the same all the time. He doesn't change. He's always there. He's always there for us. You know, and sometimes, you know, we may say, you know, I don't feel like he's there. Well, you know, he hasn't moved. Usually it's us, we're the ones that have moved. You know, and usually it's because we have moved in the wrong direction. Back a number of years ago, I had a friend of mine that was going through a trying time, and she said to me, I was visiting with him, and she said, I don't feel like prayer's doing any good and God's listening. And I've been known to give what people call the look to somebody. And she said she got the look. And she knew that when she had said it, that she had said the wrong thing. Because I turned around and reminded her how many things that God had blessed them with. Miracles that had happened that could have been much more tragic. You see, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's always with you on your journey. And you're not alone. Even though you might feel like you're alone, you're not. You see, up to this point, we've talked about some very practical ways that you can deal with fear. Recognizing it and giving it back to God through prayer. Keeping your focus one day at a time are powerful habits that can be developed. It's so easy to forget about doing that one day at a time. You start looking a week, a month, or a year down the road. No, he tells us one day at a time. And so we have to discipline ourselves, self-discipline, to start thinking that way. You see, he added and gave us the spirit of self-discipline, and you start that feeling sometimes that you're invincible. And so, why do you feel times that you're anything but invincible? I mean, sometimes you just feel like nothing goes right. I like to call it the can't help it days. It just seems like everything that you're doing is going wrong. Everything falls apart, you know, and you just kind of have your own little pity party. But then when you think about what Jesus did for us, you know, he did so much for us. He took the whips for us before he went to the cross. And I don't know how many of you have ever been hit by a whip. I have. I was talking with my brother last night as we were eating supper and celebrating my dad's 83rd birthday last night. And we were sitting there talking about some of the things we did when we were young. Well, one time we had traveled out to Texas. And while we were out there, you know, we were kids, and that was back during rawhide days and wagon train and the cowboys, they'd have whips and, you know. So we both got us real leather horse whips. And I was at home. We were at home one day, and he had one of those horse whips. And he hit me. Back then, we run around barefooted. We didn't wear Crocs and tennis shoes and everything. When it was summertime, we were barefooted. But he hit me across my bare foot with that leather whip, and it felt like my foot had been cut off. And I sat there and thought about that. As we were talking about it, I said, imagine the pain that Jesus went through when he took the whips and the stripes for us. I just had one whip that day. But here it is, 50-something years later, and I still remember the pain of that whip. You see, Jesus is there for us, and he reminds us that we're not alone through this. Joshua was promised a land last week, and we talked briefly about the 12 spies and the promised land in Numbers 13 and 14. But in the middle of this story, a young man named Joshua, and you'll recognize his name as he's the chosen one to succeed Moses. He is chosen to take over the leadership and take God's people to the promised land. And yes, the same land that 40 years earlier that Caleb believed that the Lord would provide. But let's look at Joshua chapter 1, if you'll turn in your Bibles to Joshua chapter 1. It says, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land that I am about to give them. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised to Moses. No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you, and I will never leave you nor forsake you. And then a few verses later, God says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Now, he tells us, don't be terrified. Don't be discouraged because, you know, I'm with you. And we've got to remember that. That's a promise that he's given us. Essentially, he says, you're not alone. I'm always with you. And he is. He's always there with you. You might not realize it, and you might not act like it. But let's go ahead and jump to the New Testament. Let's go to Matthew chapter 28. And at the very end, the very last verse of the gospel, he says, in chapter 28, verse 20, he said, and surely I am with you always to the very end of age. I am with you always to the very end of age. How terrified the disciples must have been to think about sharing the good news without Jesus. I mean, after all, he told them that they were going to abandon him. And they all did. They denied him. But they came back stronger. Many of the disciples, they ran and you didn't hear anything else from them. They took off. They left Jesus hanging. They didn't have a bus back then, so I guess they just kind of threw him out and let the wagons run over them or whatever, but they left him because they were terrified. But here's the thing. Jesus gave a powerful message and told them that he was going to be with them even to the very end. Now here's the question, has the truth changed after all these years? No. It's still the same truth as it was then, as it was yesterday, as it is today, and as it will be tomorrow. The truth has not changed. Jesus Christ came and died on the cross for us and our sins. And all we have to do is accept it. That's the truth. He says that he would be with us to the end of age. Has the end of age happened yet? No. A lot of people speculating, you know, could this be the what Revelation's talked about? Could this be the tribulation period? I'm going to say no. It's probably some warning signs that we need to make heed to. Because our country has gone in the wrong direction with a lot of stuff. I mean, after all, you know, we have elections coming up. And you need to think about something. Some people, especially when you start talking about pro-life and that you should have the right to have an abortion if you want to, even all the way up to birth. I mean, that's not a whole lot different than what Hitler did back in Germany. I mean, you're taking a life, and you're taking this life just because you decide it's not going to be easy for you, and so you terminate it, and that baby never gets born. And so we have got today in society where that is common, and people really aren't in an uproar over it. The churches should be in an uproar about it. The Christians should be in an uproar about it. Because here's the thing. We have become so desensitized with that, that it's not going to be long, because now they say, well, we've got this, and so now we'll start having people in old age, and we'll start euthanizing them. If they have Alzheimer's, we'll go ahead and euthanize them. We'll start taking care of the ones that are a debt, a burden on the government. You see, you better start thinking about the directions that things are going, because the end hasn't happened yet, but we need to wake up and pay attention. No, it hasn't changed, and the end hasn't come yet, but Jesus is still alive. He's well, and he's with you, right where he said he would be. If you've accepted him as your Lord and Savior, he is with you. One more point about Jesus is that he is always incredibly honest with his disciples. I mean, he just said it like it was. Even though they didn't like the truth or couldn't understand what he was saying, he was always gave them the unvarnished truth. You see, in the Gospels, John chapter 16, he says, the time is coming and has come when you will be scattered, each to his own home. You will leave me alone, yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me. I have told you these things so that you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, be encouraged. I have overcome the world. He told them it was going to happen. And after Jesus was arrested and eventually put to death, the disciples were scattered and many of them were hiding. Many of them went back homes. And, you know, they were discouraged. But they forgot the promise. He said, he promised that he wasn't going to leave them, but did they promise? No, the disciples did exactly the opposite. He promised to never leave, but they did. They left him. And what a promise he told them, verse 33, that there would definitely be trouble in this life. We all have trouble in life. It doesn't matter who you are or where you are, how much money you have or don't have. We all have troubles in life. The word trouble is defined in Strong's dictionary as affliction or tribulation or oppression. Distress more generally describes a pressure and oppressing together. In other words, you could say in this world that you have pressure and affliction and oppression and distress, which I imagine we can all identify with some form or another. Everybody's had it. Everybody's got it right now. And you're going to have it. However, the real pressure is in your life right now, and whatever trouble or distress is yet to come, we celebrate today because Jesus has overcome the world. We celebrate that. Whatever's coming, he's in control. There's been several people this week that I've talked with, and I said, whatever happens, Jesus got it. You see, in fact, he says, take heart in verse 33 and remind us, he says, Don't be discouraged and don't be afraid. How many Christians do you see that are running around discouraged and afraid of things that are happening? You see, he's got it. You know, if tribulation come, if he returns, I'm not worried about it. I know where I'm going. I'm going to go be up here with those angels driving around. No matter how difficult it gets, no matter how impossible the odds may seem, we have a promise that God, who is bigger and stronger than any giants we may see on the horizon. I don't care what your problem is, what your issue is. He's bigger than it is. We stand with the one who has already overcome, the one who chose to stand with us until the very end of age. You see, when Jesus is added to our habits that we've been building and forming throughout the series, you can begin to see how someone like Paul was able to say with confidence in Philippians 4:13 that I can do everything through him who gives me strength. That's confidence. And we have to remember that I can do everything through him who gives me strength, and that's Jesus. See, when you know that the Savior of the universe is committed to standing with you through every trial, every season, every affliction, and literally everything and every walk and every step you take in life, confidence also should be in your step. You see, there's a little spark in your eyes and boldness in the moves as you make your way through life, and you've got Jesus with you. You've got that little glimmer that other people see, and they want to know what you got. When you tell somebody, when they ask you how you're doing, you tell them, better than I deserve. Whoa, tell me what's got you there. I tell them Jesus. You see, it's not the fear, the anxiety, the worry, or the doubt that don't exist, but it's that they have a proper place and in capable hands, and that's when we put them in Christ. So keep recognizing the healthy fear in your life and dealing with it appropriately. Don't worry about tomorrow, but keep your energy focused on today. And above all else, remember that Jesus is with you every step of the way. He walks with you and talks with you. You see, I might not be able to give you the audible voice of God today like Joshua, but we've got an edge on the promised land and the disciples got from Jesus, but I can give you the same encouragement that the Lord had given throughout the Bible to his people. Don't be afraid and don't be discouraged. And fear not, because God and Jesus are with you always until the very end. They will never leave you, and they will never forsake you. Let's pray. Lord God, our Father, we thank you for being there with us. It really feels that this could be a great place for people to start turning their lives around and committing and recommitting their lives in Christ. There will undoubtedly be members of the congregation that are struggling with fear and ailments and they feel are holding them back. And Lord, we pray that you will help them to be encouraged to take a step of faith, to trust you, and to believe that Christ is who he says he is, and will do what he said he will do. We pray that you be with me as the pastor of the church here at Mount Zion, that I can lead them in the way that you would have me to lead, and that they will become involved. You see, what great encouragement it would be to both you and our church for those that are willing to come and be with us and worship together. Lord, we look forward to the day that we can come back safely and not having to worry about our health and worship together in your congregation. But you told us to fear not, so we will come back together. And Lord, as we do, we're going to give you the honor, we're going to give you the glory, and we're going to lay it all before you to have carry the load. Lord, I ask if there's anyone here today that's listening, watching, that doesn't know you, that they will accept you as our Lord and Savior. Those that have issues going on, that they will lay those issues before you. Lord, we give you the honor and we give you the glory for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Always there with you. He's never going to leave you, and he's never going to forsake you. He will be with you to the end. Have a good week.